Good evening, everybody. Welcome to St. Catharines, welcome to Brock, and welcome to the 28th Annual 2 Days of Canada Conference keynote address. My name is Gregory Betts. I am the Director of Canadian Studies at Brock University, and it is my pleasure to welcome you here today. But I would like to begin by acknowledging that we are gathering in Haudenosaunee territory. Carol Jacobs of the Cayuga Nation was scheduled to welcome all of us to the conference into this territory this morning, but she was pulled away to attend to the illness of a chief in the Six Nations. She sends her welcome. This is an auspicious occasion and an important gathering in many respects. To welcome us here today, I am pleased to present Dr. Douglas Neal, Dean of the Faculty of Humanities at Brock University.
Thank you, Gregory. Greetings, everyone. In the fait bon plaisir de vous souhaiter la bienvenue à Brock. On behalf of the Faculty of Humanities, I'm delighted to welcome all of you, and especially our first-time visitors to Brock and to our Rodman Hall Art Center. It's a gorgeous venue, is it not, for this kind of an event? Yes, it is. Sure. As Gregory said, welcome to the 28th episode of 2 Days of Canada. The standing joke has been that Gregory had so much good material to put on the program that he would have to increase 2 days to 3. And that has, in fact, happened. What an enormously rich program we have, with participants all the way from UBC to Dalhousie. Now, it takes a lot of work to put together a conference such as this, and I want to thank Gregory, who is our current Chancellor's Chair for Research Excellence and the Director of Canadian Studies at Brock University. I want to thank Gregory and his team for such a forward-looking theme, Avant Canada, Artists, Prophets, and Revolutionaries. Now, as a romanticist, I dig all three. And I understand that there were even a few references to William Wordsworth this morning, my main man. So I think we're in good company. Well, it's been a full day today, and I know that tomorrow and Friday promise to be likewise. It's a princely heap of a program that Gregory and his team have put together. Would you join me in thanking him and them for all the work they've done? I want to acknowledge the support of the Social Sciences and Humanities Research Council of Canada, Editing Modernism in Canada, the Niagara Artists Centre, and the Centre for Canadian Studies at Brock University. What a fitting moment for Brock to be hosting this conference. We were born in 1964, 3 years before the centennial of Confederation. Earlier this year, more than 8,000 delegates came to Brock to the Congress of the Humanities and Social Sciences on the theme of Borders Without Boundaries, Frontières Sans Limites. And as Dean of Humanities, I'm pleased to acknowledge just not our teaching and our research, but also our community connections, which would be our $100 million downtown project, the new home of our Marilyn I. Walker School of Fine and Performing Arts, being built in collaboration with the City of St. Catharines Performing Arts Center, and both of those are just on the other side of the Boyne Bridge that some of you were doubtless traveling today, just across 12 Mile Creek. And 1 year from now, we will be moving 500 students, staff, and faculty into a new state-of-the-art facility in a 19th century textile factory located on the site of a former Welland Canal. And when the original site was there, it was about a quarter of a century avant Canada as we know it. It's a hugely exciting opportunity. I think of it as the perfect metaphor for Niagara's industrial past and her post-industrial future. We are taking Blake's dark satanic mills of industrialization and giving them a rebirth as a vortex of creativity for our students in fine performing arts. What an opportunity. And finally, here in Niagara, post-1812, 1812, 2012, we are celebrating 200 years of peace among three nations. And not just peace, peace indeed, but not just peace. Friendship, fellowship, cooperation, trade, and travel. And this year, of course, we're also thinking about the convergence of 1914 to 2014, 100 years after the beginning of the First World War. We're thinking a little further on, 1867 to 2017, and the sesquicentennial of Canada's Confederation. A lot of dates, a lot of numbers, and I think we're going to hear something about the significance of some of those days and dates very soon. Avant de conclure, je tiens à vous souhaiter un bon café. I hope that you enjoy your remaining 2 days of Canada. And I turn things back now to Gregory to introduce our distinguished plenary speaker. Thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, my job here is very straightforward. It is my pleasure and honor to tell you about Canadian Studies at Brock University, the organizing unit for this evening, and to introduce you to the America, the heart of the event tonight. I'm actually not on the program, so I will try to be brief, but I am an academic, so my instincts tend to resist true brevity. The field of Canadian Studies is an invention of the 1960s, yet another thing you can blame on Pierre Trudeau. They don't exist only in Canada, though. In fact, there are hundreds of Canadian Studies centers all around the world. You might think that we discuss obscure hockey references and tragically hip lyrics, or debate why so many people in Japan love Anne of Green Gables. And admittedly, we do that. But what makes Canadian Studies an important space in university campuses inside and outside the country is that we look at Canadian issues, the hardest issues, holistically, from the perspective of culture, public policy, geography, spirituality, tourism, history, and more. We talk about Quebec separatism, where it comes from, how it is expressed, how it has shaped Canadian and North American history since the Quebec Act of 1774 that enraged the Americans to rebel against England. We talk about the border, the borders, class divisions, our histories of internment, and the too often overlooked legacy of slavery in Canada. The first parliament of Upper Canada, not too far from here in Niagara-on-the-Lake, enacted the abolishment of slavery 40 years before England and 70 years before the United States. Advocated and advanced by John Graves Simcoe, the Act Against Slavery was passed on July 9, 1793, but contained many concessions to Canadian slave owners that compromised the moral integrity of the bill. Slave owners could keep their existing slaves, but all children would become free at age 25. It is worth remembering that 6 of the 16 members of that legislative assembly owned slaves themselves. We talk about such things in Canadian Studies. We also talk about the fact that no new slaves could be brought into the country, but those already here remain the property of Canadians. Crossing the line, henceforward, meant freedom for American runaway slaves, but that they were still forced to see people legally enslaved because of the color of their skin. The border is often dismissed as an arbitrary line, but means something great and significant to many, though often not what we think. In Canadian Studies, we debate, discuss, interrogate, and analyze such questions. In the very near future, we will also be talking about the unfortunate incident on Halloween at Brock campus, in which 4 non-black students dressed up in blackface. We condemn the costumes, condemn the organization that awarded these students a prize for best costume, and hope to create an environment where students learn that this isn't about a joke gone bad. It's a problem because of the deep and sustained experience of racism in this country and in this region. In Canadian Studies, we also talk about borders within the country and the legacy of Canada's colonial history. We talk about the means by which the Canadian borders came to be in the first place. The philosopher John Ralston Saul recently argued that Canada as a concept, as a place, as a country, would not have existed were it not for the First Nations people who fought for the country and defended it at great sacrifice to themselves. He points to John Norton's coalition of Aboriginal forces from the Six Nations on the Grand River, who dominated the Battle of Queenston Heights, a battle, of course, fought very close to here 200 years ago, at which Sir Isaac Brock died. The Six Nations territory on Lake Erie is a further great example of the importance of First Nations communities to the possibility of Canada. That location was selected by Joseph Brant and the Six Nations in one of our most exposed regions, precisely to prevent an American invasion on the southern coast. But Sol also notes that we haven't lived up to the possibility of Canada. That when we made arrangements with people like the Haudenosaunee, we made promises that we have not kept. The treaties that we signed contained very precise details about those promises, but too often they were signed in bad faith, or else became inconvenient over the years, and we reneged on our agreements. Thomas King titled his recent history of Aboriginal people in North America, "The Inconvenient Indian," for this reason. Indeed, as King points out, the border means something quite different to the broader Aboriginal community. And I quote him saying, "For most Aboriginal people, that line doesn't exist. It is a figment of someone else's imagination." He goes on, "Most of us think that history is the past. It's not. History is the stories we tell about the past. We tell ourselves stories that Canada has come a long way since we were just a colony to France and then to Great Britain. And in many respects, we are. We have. But just as we still have a foreign queen on our money, too often have we replicated our colonial heritage against peoples and nations within our own borders. In Canadian studies, centers around the world, we study the treaties and talk about Canada's failure to keep our promises. You see, it's not all just about Tragically Hip lyrics and hockey scores. Although I note that the Hip did recently join fellow Canadian rocker Neil Young in his Respect the Treaties tour of Alberta. Even Gord Downie is talking about the importance of decolonization. As I said this morning in welcoming conference delegates to Brock, this is not the moral question of our day. It is an existential question about the very nature of Canada. What we do, whether we remain idle or idle no more, determines the future meaning of the very word Canada. Our speaker tonight, Lee Merrickle, is the ideal person to lead this conversation and to give us important perspective on such fraught and deeply problematic history. She has been writing about the experience of Canadian colonialism for over 40 years now, and has done so with a distinctly holistic consciousness and practice. She is a widely celebrated and awarded poet, novelist, storyteller, scriptwriter, essayist, and philosopher. She is a member of the Stolo Nation, the daughter of a Métis mother and Salish father, and granddaughter of Chief Dan George. She has done both stand-up comedy and sit-down activism. She's the author of 14 books, an editor or contributor to dozens of anthologies. She is currently the traditional cultural director of the Indigenous Theatre School of Toronto, and she was recently awarded the Premier's Award for Excellence in the Arts. Mm-hmm. Woo! It is my great honor in welcoming Lee Merrickle to Brock and to St. Catharines and to give the keynote address at this 28th annual 2 Days of Canada conference. Please join me in welcoming her.
The award comes with a purse of $35,000. I stared at that check all day and night. It's a check that big. So I'm 64, out of debt, and above the poverty line. I think I want to talk a little bit about memory. You probably know it as history, but really, it's memory. And I want to say that from your point of view, you select what to remember. We remember, as this fellow did, the blackface insult that occurred with those folks not too long ago. But it seems like the memory of an Aboriginal woman having beads sewn into her chest after her surgery as a joke in the same time frame is not so worthy of attention. More horrific, if you think about it, than just paint. She had to have those beads removed, and she complained to the Medical Association, which is the right thing to do, and they said, oh, well, it was just a joke. Get over it. And I think it's the same way with residential school. It's not that it was a joke, but everyone wants us to get over it. And when they want us to get over the pillage of the land that occurred during the process of residential school, and the prohibition laws that affected our adult population during residential school, the lack of medicine during that time, the killing of animals on a massive scale during that time, and just proceeding all over the country, and it still goes on today in the West Coast, they're slaughtering salmon on an unprecedented scale, and many of us are trying to stop it, particularly Starbucks or Salish people, as you know us. The Stavo are connected to the Salish people, part of the Confederacy. Thank you. What a joke. You remembered I drink water. because the Chinook salmon, or the big tai, whatever you want to call it, the spring salmon, are endangered. And the people in the south fought fishing rights until they won co-management. And as co-managers, they only needed one white guy in the state legislature to agree with them, and they would be able to ban Chinook salmon. We call it tai in the north. Doesn't matter. The thing is, these two salmons are the same salmon, and its biggest playground is in Puget Sound, or the Salish Sea, or whatever they're, I don't know why they changed it to Salish Sea, because that's very hard for Salish people to say. We would say, if we're saying it fast, we'd say Salish Sea. A lot of our people calling it that now, Salish Sea. They changed the name. I don't know what the name was before, but it started with not Salish. Anyhow, they stopped the Chinook salmon because they saw this went good, and they talked them into it. The Indians are 50%, and that was one individual. And then the late legislature agreed with them. And then they got sued by all the fishing corporations, multinational outfits, because they couldn't prove that the farm fish from the Atlantic is not the same as the Chinook wild fish from the Pacific. So it's ongoing, that battle. But it's not well remembered anywhere. And it's not well remembered that we fought that as a united Starbucks or Salish people. Salish Sea, I still can't say Salish. Who invented that word anyway? Some, what do you call those? Anthropologists. Anyhow, we fought it as a united people for 44 years. And even when we win, we don't. So that becomes the problem. And that's what Canadians constantly forget. These treaties aren't just promises. They're not just promises. They're agreements not to kill you. I think you should remember that. I think we're not the kind of people that go around, you know, arbitrarily killing people like the crazy guy Yibo that's being called a terrorist and isn't. No, he's just a crazy guy. But we're not those kind of people. We've been civilized for a long time. The Confederacy here has had a constitution for over 1,000 years. They used to say 300. I don't know if you know that. The white guys, we always knew it's 1,000 years. But then when someone actually went and heard it recited, it starts with this particular comment, because we always name the context. It was a time when this comic was a little left. It was a time when blah, 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 you know, and all that stuff. And he thought, that comic wasn't there 300 years ago. So he started researching and found that it was 1,000 years ago. So we're the first democracy in the world that has accorded women rights, property rights, the kind of rights that holds the purse, that says, this is how we're going to do business with each other. No, we're not buying a stereo. We're going to purchase good clothes for the kids, you know, those kinds of decisions. If we had women in charge, if we're truly in charge of the purse for a long period of time, as the Six Nations did, and as the Salish people at home do still, which controls what we consume, we wouldn't be in the situation we are today, where the majority of production is in China. You go to a grocery store, the majority of food there isn't, has no nutritional value whatsoever, and we're suffering from obesity, arthritis, bursitis, all number of diseases that have weird names, thousands of them. Do you know in 1835 there were 3,000 diseases in North America? And by 1960 it was 35,000 and increasing exponentially from wrong food, from eating things that killed you, not the least of which was sugar, which is the reason for slavery. That's why they brought the slaves from Africa, so they could produce sugar and feed it to children all over the world and get them drunk, basically, turn them into bunch of alcoholics, and in the end, destroy their bodies and their minds and their hearts too. The mind changer. The Haudenosaunee saw that in these people that came here. And then we have stories like that, about making sure that we don't poison our children before they reach a certain age. Well, that's not something we remember very much in this country. It's not something that we remember or pay attention to. We don't pay attention, for instance. We pay attention to 1812. I appreciate that. You're Canadians. You're not Haudenosaunee. And you're knowledgeable. But I pay attention because I'm not either of those things. But I must follow. I must pay attention to the agreements that existed here before me, which means before Canada. Yeah? Before Canada, there was agreements here. There was the Six Nations Constitution. Actually, five nations and then later six. Now I think there's 168 nations sitting under the Tree of Peace. My nation is one of them. Welcome to our world. And following that was the Treaty of the Dish with One Spoon. We also live here. And that's the first major international treaty in which the Ojibwe declined to sit under the Treaty of Peace, but agreed to share a common law. And between the Okutsu-Dabako and the Geowin, which is the great binding law, and the Haudenosaunee Constitution, they came to an understanding of this place from Fort Erie all the way to Montreal. You are in the Treaty of the Dish with One Spoon. And so what does that mean to you? What does it make you want to remember? If you just swallow that idea, that concept, then you're going to change the way you see things. One dish, one spoon. That means we're all eating out of the same pot, people. And it means we've got to share. It's a sharing arrangement. And there's eight wampums that goes with that treaty. Eight wampums that the Haudenosaunee and the Ojibwe renew and commit to one another. When Canada chased the Mississaugas out of Toronto Island, who took them in? The Confederacy. Part of the Treaty of the Dish with One Spoon is that we're going to take care of each other. So it's not just a sharing arrangement. It means if someone's fallen, you pick them up. That's why they joined that war.
not to help Canada. It's because they had a treaty called the Jay Treaty with England, which preceded the 1812 war, but was after the dish with one spoon. So you got the dish with one spoon, then you got the Jay Treaty. Now, America still recognizes the Jay Treaty, but Canada says no pre-1867 agreements. Good that Canada doesn't exist. And we're allowed to start again. Because that's what it means. Before there was 1867, there was all these agreements that exist in this country. And renewing them is part of your responsibility as Canadians. But you need to remember something different than you're currently remembering. We need to switch the way we remember and switch how we remember. And then you'll see that what's happening today is a recolonization, a deepening of the colonialism that existed before. It's the penetration of the North and the rape of the North, which is what happened in the South here. And because it's fait accompli and it all looks like Canada, whatever that concept is, we forget that it happened. But it's only beginning now in the North, and the results are dire. The Inuits are killing themselves, children, at 13 times the national average and 6 times that of Aboriginal people. That's horror. It's a horror show. And it's going on as we speak. But this is what colonialism is, and those who speak of decolonization, I want to kind of explain what that is. Decolonizing your mind is one thing. That's changing what you remember and changing the way you look at things. But decolonization period is this. $6 billion a year comes out of James Bay and goes to the government of Canada. That's ending that and saying that $6 billion belongs to James Bay. It's in James Bay territory. It's in the treaty area of James Bay. And no Canadian has any business building it. And then giving them $1 million a year in return. That's not even the crumbs off the floor of your dog food. You need to look at things differently. You need to reconsider. And now they're going to do it in Alberta, Enbridge, and all those guys are going to Alberta. Canada stands to make the Canadian government. This is not the corporations, they make much more. But the Canadian government itself stands to make another $6 billion a year. In order to get that, they've been keeping the North in a state of semi-starvation. The Diné were promised a reserve 70 years ago, are constantly being shifted in places in the North where there's no caribou, and they're slowly dying. Tuberculosis and starvation. It's going on now. So anybody that says we should get over it should remember that we know something about this country. It doesn't stop. It doesn't stop until Canada has everything. And I think Tom King said that. When people say, he said, when, you know, my people ask me, what do Indians want? I realize that I've been trying to answer that for decades, and it's the wrong question. But what do my people want? They want the land. Pretty clear. But some of us, not the least of which is you, some of us have woken up. And I think of Canada as the sleeping giant. You know, when I first wrote a book, some of you read Dobby Lee, and then I asked for questions. This guy says, what are you going to do? Throw us into the sea? And I said, thank you. Just like that. Everybody started laughing. Did you think I could? All 30 million of you. What a concept. So no, I'm also a descendant of the Prince of Peace, so I've no interest in throwing you anywhere. And then I asked for the next question. And he said he wasn't finished. I said, you are. Next question. And the
audience froze. They didn't know what to do. People were afraid to ask questions unless this white guy got mad at them. But then I said, okay, there's no questions, I'm going to go home then. And someone could find me up there, too. We carried on. His overblown sense of entitlement has a history, even though this country doesn't seem to. I'm really sad sometimes when I start to talk about Canada and the absence of any. I was sitting at the convocation of whatever it is when they give citizenship, and I was one of the speakers there for the first time. They had made a speaker. And the deputy minister was from Africa, a black man. And he says in his speech, when new citizens come here, I say, forget everything you knew before. This is Canada. Forget everything. And I think that is why we're such a mess. We're brought here, all of us. You're brought here and expected to forget who you are. That is not possible. That is not possible. And you experience shame when you try. And then we mistreat the immigrants that come here. This is not the first time we've mistreated immigrants. The Ukrainians in 1905, the Chinese in 1860. You can just go, the black slaves and before that, you just go on and on and on. No immigrant has been welcomed to this land by England. And England had dominated this land till 1867. And then when Canada took over, they kept up that wonderful tradition of mistreating the immigrants. That's been its way since the very beginning. But we forget that, because as immigrants, you're expected to forget. So then we become a country without a significant memory. This immigrant that's here in Toronto is voting against giving new immigrants medicine. And how they suffered with no medicine is already forgotten. I pulled myself up by the bootstraps, did two jobs, worked 40, 60 hours a week, and neglected my children in the process, so can everybody else. And then we have become a country without love, without family, without social relations. Our children leave us and go all over the place, over to Edmonton and Quebec and hardly write letters. You know, we're a country of vagabonds. You go to live anywhere in Toronto, wait 2 weeks and you've got a whole new neighborhood. I can't believe how much we keep moving and keep shifting and never sinking root and never looking at, where am I? Just, you know, think about that. I was sleeping on that bus, I came over here. I woke up, I didn't know where I was. I said, where am I? And this woman said, Grimsby. Sounds awful, it's grim. Oh, that's so significant for what I can see. We're really in Grimsby. We're Grimsville. And we need to move beyond that. Just some happier happenstance. And we have that capacity as Canadians. I want to say this about us that's different from the United States. And I know from BC's history, we have both Americans and British as subjects, as the founders, white founders of British Columbia, and that makes a big difference. The descendants of the Yale founders are still killing Aboriginal women. And it keeps on going. Picton is a descendant of Yale founders. I want you to remember that, because we can tell you something about the difference between Canada and the United States. And this is something Canadians don't know because they forgot, right? It's not the thing you want to remember. You don't want to remember where you came from. Well, they had rules. The king made all these declarations in England about who could go where. If you could read a stitch, you couldn't go to the United States. So they had a great anti-intellectual tradition there. And a robust, you know, kick-ass, get a motherfucker kind of attitude. We think it's really funny. But it's not very intelligent, I'll tell you. When I discovered reading, I was and libraries. I was 13, and I read 5,000 books by the time I was 18. And I tell you, I had a lot of good actors in my house. I like Voltaire. I like Lenezarab. I like Dickens. I like Chekhov. I like all these people that came before me and had an idea about justice and could read. Because it opens you up to remembering from where you are, that is my sense of justice, and expanding the world of who you can be. And I realized that it's an amazing place that we have here. So, Canadians read from the beginning. That's also a conservative kind of marker too, in a strange way, because when you go to school, you have to learn to behave. Yeah, go the British way. But then we got independence. And because we didn't have much in memory, we tried to remember everything British. And that's interesting because, from my standpoint, at one time, everything was England. And Canada is still, to a large degree, England to me. You're all beholden to the monarchy. The Queen just sabotaged the return of a piece of land which would have been my village. She still has power over me. 2010. I'm still, colonized by the Queen. And of course, the Canadian government called her in to do that. Now, if no pre-1867 agreements can apply, then that shit can't go on either.
Yeah?
So we need to read something different. I was active during the 1990 OCA crisis, and somebody published some answers. The Mercier Bridge, that everybody fought over so terribly, was built on loans from, guess who? The Iroquois Confederacy. Canada does not own that bridge because it has not paid the loans. It's forgotten. Now it's worth $80 million to forget that little fact. And going up. And that's why you can't forget. That's why you can't forget. Now, we can do it the way we're doing it back home. Piece at a time. Another $1 million is going to cost you. It's going to cost you another $60 million, $90 million, $100 million, $200 million. I don't care. But you're going to stop preventing us from living a full life. One way or another. Or we can sit down like an avant-garde and say, who do we want to be? So, decolonization is recognizing, first of all, that this is not England, it never was. And that Canada is really a hook-and-shoulder word for a village. And my people discovered that the Canadian government has no more authority over a treaty area than anybody else. They only have authority over the band government. The treaty area is held in custom. So that means my Siams, me, and my aunts are in charge. Means we know what to do with that territory. And we need to make decisions about that. Now, if everybody catches up to that fact, all the Aboriginal people catch up to that fact, we're going to start making decisions like the Six Nations made decisions back in the 90s to have the cigarette trade. And they tried everything to stop them. And they can't. If you behave like a nation, you are one. And so we're starting to catch on to that. And we're starting to realize that Canada won't prosecute us on certain issues because they have to prove they're in charge. And they are not. They cannot prove that this is their country.
So it means it's open to all of us. Now, I'm up for discussion about it, but we start with what's real. You can't move into my house, put me in the doghouse, and then charge me for renting the doghouse anymore. Because that's what happened. We're being forced to pay for our own knowledge. When they set up residential school, it was so that people wouldn't pass on knowledge to the children, right? They moved the children. So they did that. We didn't get that knowledge passed on. And a whole bunch of anthropologists went out and started taping all these old Native people and putting the knowledge in universities like this. Now we've got to pay to come here to learn to be us. Oh, it doesn't work that way. We need a new arrangement. And I appreciate that you mentioned slavery. But before there were black slaves, there were Native slaves. They just didn't work out so well because Native slaves didn't want to kill you. I wonder what happened to the black slaves, but it's not their territory. Maybe that was it. Maybe they were so homesick and so broke by the time they made that ship crossing, like the Irish, the terrible ship crossings that happened. And maybe we should look at that, what happened on those ships. Maybe we should face that too, because we came here, as the immigrants that came here, came on terrible crossings and had terrible experiences, and maybe we should be talking about that so that you can help yourselves to be open to the memories that are not yours. If you deny your own memories, you won't want to hear anybody else's. Somebody said that to me, oh, I don't want to read any of your books because then I'll have to remember what it was like to be an immigrant family when I was 10. We have to remember that. Because it doesn't change for the people coming behind you. 600,000 were immigrants in this country. And we were worried about Little Windsor with its 20,000 workers in the car industry. But every year, 600,000 immigrants, 600,000 artists leaving below the poverty line. 600,000 Native people below the poverty line. These things don't disturb us because we have to remember ourselves to do something about it. You know, working in a car factory at $40 an hour, that's a happy memory. It's not so happy when it gets taken away, but the bailout sounds good. This country is not anywhere near fair. They like to think of fair play, but it doesn't have that either. It doesn't have that in its history. The only attempt at a revolution in Canada, actually only two attempts, this one was supported by Quebec, all the way to Manitoba, was Louis Riel. Right? Everybody had to vote, white people, Native people, women, everybody, for a short period of time. And they learned how to share with each other, even though they didn't speak each other's languages. Even the Scots that were there had land. A whole bunch of people with all kinds of languages managed to get together and say, yeah, this is Manitoba, land of God. We're going to stick it out. And they were defeated. And so what happens? They call Louis Riel a madman, and we forget that he had a 20-point program of democracy that still is unrivaled in this country. It's still unrivaled. They're going to talk about women, the debaters, eh? I don't know if you know this, but I'd like to tell you this. Aboriginal women earn 55 cents compared to a white guy's dollar. And we're the highest paid women in the country. Did you know that? I have a degree. I make 55 cents on my next dollar. I would have made 54. That's the first time in history. There's something wrong with this picture, ladies. I want that as 35 cents. I want to be straight across the table. And not when we're all impoverished either. Not when the economy is dead and crashed.
we want it right now. And if you're a woman of color, it's 48 cents. That's after all the feminism that this country has experienced. We can't seem to make the least bit of progress on any of this. And I think it's because we're not remembering the right things. We have to remember where we come from. And where we in Ontario come from is the treaty of the dish with one spoon, where women have power, where we share things together. That is the intent of this area. And not just one person, and not just some of you, but everyone. That was the intent of the treaty of the dish with one spoon, and it still is. And so we've got to start figuring out where we're going to go from there and what we want this country to look like 100 years from now. And start mapping that out. And start figuring that out. And I know we have great minds. I'm one of them. And this country, for what it's worth, personally, with all its warts and all its troubles, and all its catastrophic behavior, this country first. We do birth billions. And we have to also remember. We have to remember different things. We've got to stop forgetting that there's indigenous people that have had a horrifying journey to come to this place in this century. And we have to remember the agreements we made and restore them the way I restored my agreement with Sarah, the way I restored my agreement with Will, the way I restored my agreement with the Scotland's people, the way I restored my agreement with you. You know what my grandpa used to say? I said, well, they've broken their agreements, you know, as far as I'm concerned. It's just, it's all hell let out on bread business. He said, we made that agreement not just to them. We made it to ourselves, to our ancestors. You need to have every single Stockmix person dead and living to change that agreement. Oh.
Okay, maybe not.
Maybe there's another way. But it begins with looking this way. If you really want to decolonize, you're going to lose a country. But you may gain some your humanity. You have to make that. What's your humanity worth doing? You may gain something very much better than what you have. You may gain something that I have. I am never afraid of a thing called unemployment. I have family. I have community. I have a place. It's not a territory. And they always tell me. I can always go home and say, oh, no, my publisher died and they owe me a bunch of money. You can always come home. I don't need to earn a living. I like to earn a living. My mother raised me without having a living. She went to school after I left home. I just lived off the land. I can still do that. I have a different way of living. And you might learn something from it. Because when you share, maybe you don't have so much, but you have what everyone in this country is always talking about, security. Food security, housing security, security of all sorts, emotional security. Canadians don't have that. It's a different way of living. We might have to look at alternatives. Maybe the 1% don't deserve everything. Maybe they haven't earned it. Think about these things. Maybe raping the North is not the best plan. Maybe living with less is a better plan. Trinkets and the baubles. What do you really need? Anyway, that's all I got to say about it.
$400 a year, mill rate, to go to school. What do Native kids pay?
They already pay.
Yes, that's true, but what do we still pay? 15,000 tuition. We're the only people in the world that gotta pay tuition to go to kindergarten. Not even the poorest countries in Africa do have little kindergartners have to pay tuition. So, by the time we finish grade 12, if we get that far, we've paid almost $200,000 in education. And then they tell us this: you guys get education free when you're in university. I said, no, you still owe me a master's, a PhD, and a bunch of fellowships. You still owe me $130,000 after I finish my graduate, my undergrad studies. Yeah. We've been subsidizing Canadian education for a very long time. I have to say I'm very proud of myself when I found this out. I told my kids, don't tell them your styles, you're a bunch of 18. And they didn't take my kids' money. But that's where the $20 billion goes. And this is what happens. October 31st, they get the check. Now in the north, on November 1st, everybody 14 and over starts getting expelled. And they keep the check. So they can't even let us have that little bit, and it is a little bit. So you need to find out about these things. And in order to find out about these things, you have to go through the Freedom of Information Act. You have to know the band you're talking about. Even you have to know the file. That's not freedom of information. So we can struggle as Canadians for transparency. That they should state where all this money goes. Instead of putting us in third-party receivership for complaining. That's how you do it. We complain about black mold. And they put them in third-party receivership. So we can stop that practice by harassing them via the internet. We now harass the government every week. Just as a matter of course. It could be anything. I don't care. You know how you treat birds. You know what? There's nothing good about Canada's government right now. But make a plan for yourself. What kind of a country do you want? Get together with some colleagues. Start looking at what was here before. And then start making that country happen. At least here in St. Catharines. At least here in St. Catharines. What can St. Catharines, what can Brock University do to restore the cultural life of Indigenous people and not charge us for it?
Free tuition would be one.
Well, that's the university taking on Canada's problem. I mean, I'm thinking, like, you know, I don't know, we have language classes at First Nations House in D.C. They're free for the community. You know, the community can come and we sit around and speak the language. It's not really a class. It's not accredited. You know, people just sit around and get a chance at space and time and some language speakers, you know, from the community. And they're paid to come and sit with us and you know, talking about the language. And so it's restoring the language. Because while we were being robbed of our language, Canadians were getting ahead in university. Right? And they had all of these programs that I had the president of the University of Toronto once tell me, well, you don't have a program, you don't have a department, so you can't have that. And we don't have a department because you never had Native Studies in 1905. Right? Because we couldn't go to university till 1968, I mentioned that. So you got ahead and now we're behind and you're saying we can't have this money? We raised it and you were gonna take it from us? When does the pillaging of Indians stop? When does it stop? We raised $3 million so we could have a full-time, what do you call those, a tenured professor, so we could be a department. They took it because of your time. And he was horrified. He resigned. But we didn't get the $3 million. So, things like that happen every day, all the time. But you're in a different space. You need to look at Canada again. And look at what's here, and where you want it to go. And start making plans with other people. I know we can take care of the little ignorant problems we have like that, you know. The business it's like the $3 million, because they're getting better and better presidents. They did, the university didn't like that remark. And everybody heard about it, because I'm a noisy little squeak. you don't need to really help us, you need to look at what kind of country you want and start mapping out your participation in that. Now I have an hour and a half volunteer time every week. That's all I have. That's all most of us have, if you're women especially, because you're busy cleaning and washing and, you know, doing all that stuff. But I have that hour and a half, and I make sure I'm doing something to create the kind of Canada I want. Well, let's see if anybody else wants to ask me something, and then we'll follow up with you. Anybody else? Going once, twice, okay. Follow up.
So what I see is an attempt at cultural genocide through the erasure of memory.
Yes.
And so
for Canadians as well as us. You don't even feel sorry for us people, they've got it to you too.
So it looks like Thomas King's Indian Help as a starting point for people to learn about what they're missing so that we can resurrect the memory.
Yes, exactly.
There's another angle that I'm a little concerned about that goes global, and that is your reference to the 1%. Right now, 75 people own 50% of the planet's wealth. And so if you're talking about the oilocracy in Athabasca, you're talking about big pharmaceuticals, you're talking about Monsanto taking over food, etc., the banking corps, we're in for a bit of a struggle here, and it's not just what's going to happen in Canada, it's going to happen globally. And so maybe, that hole's going to have to get bigger and that spoon's going to have to get a little bigger.
And we're having to get a lot smarter. I think, revolutions have failed because we haven't taken time to transform ourselves. That's my biggest thing in the world. Russia made a revolution that failed. China made a revolution that failed. So revolution by itself isn't enough. There needs to be a transformation that occurs within. And I have to tell you this, buddy. I come from a transformation-based culture. So we can help you with that. We can help you with the kind of healing and transformation we need to make to get you from step one to step two. But first you have to have the vision, which is what looking at what was here first, and who's here now, and what kind of a Canada do I want to see, and then start mapping out the steps that it's going to take, getting together with like-minded people, sharing the vision, changing the vision, all of this sort of stuff. Maybe holding conferences on vision, what we want, what we need. But this is the first one of this kind, right? Maybe we need another one every year until we get a handle on where we're going with all this. Yeah. I think this country has a spirit. We just don't know what it is yet. I think the people that are here want something different. I think that's why they came here. A lot of people that came here. So, they didn't talk to anybody else though. They were too busy working two or three jobs to try and survive. And then their kids went to school. And then they got somehow fractured, like the rest of us. It's a kind of cultural genocide. It is. We haven't had an opportunity to create a Canadian culture. And we do need to do that. Thank you for that. Anybody else? Yes, ma'am.
I don't know if I missed it. Remind me later, you're talking about the murder of missing Indigenous women, so remind me later to tell you the difference between Canada and America.
Yes, well, it's the Yale Towers. The 1840s, the American gold rush failed. Gold rushers came into Canada and started participating in the gold rush in the interior, and they killed a lot of women and made children. And so the nations gathered together to kill them. And this one chief convinced them not to, but they sent them packing. And they ended up in a place called Yale Town, which is a very specific place in Vancouver that's just being rebuilt now into big apartments and stuff. But it was a dive for a very long time when these people lived there. And they would, you know, run into Chinatown and leave the little kids there, run only the black guy. The blacks left because of the first 600 families of blacks that left. They just left. They were the most horrible excuses for human beings. They were always driving and run over to snow, which is my village. When the adults weren't there and you know, raped the children and pillaged them and people were wondering what to do with them and so on and so forth. But they stayed in BC. Nobody tossed them out, despite their horrific behavior. And they eventually moved into the hills, which is where Lynn Valley is and you know, all those places in upper North Vancouver, and became the kind of working lumberjacks and whatnot, and a very notorious history. And then they became the roofers and whatnot, you know, scallywags, one and all. And then it ended up, one of them, the descendant of these people, is picked in the family of the farm, the human beings to the farm, including me and my cousins. And we knew this was going on, and we complained about it to the RCMP about these guys. It was consistent from the time they arrived and continues today. It happened to me. The murder of missing women, I know I had learned to be a kickboxer to defend myself against these fellows. And they would come into our community and grab our little girls and take them to the ground a bit, rape them and dump them there, and few of them died. And my uncle finally shot at them, and that stopped it coming into our reserve. But it was constantly running away from these guys. And when we went to the police, they'd say, it's all taking place in your imagination. Who would want to rape you? And so I'm reminded of Dimeshi, right? What did they say to that woman who complained? Are you trying to start up a toxic environment? He's beating her, but she's complaining, and that's a toxic environment. Now, we gotta stop that. The rape culture that goes with colonialism has to end. It goes with war and it goes with colonialism. Didn't Canadians rape in Somalia? Of course they did. We've got to stop the war and the colonization and the rape culture that goes with it. Those are our three obligations to humanity. So that's what I know about that. You can trace their origins. BC's not very old. Eh? You guys have been stepped on here for about 400 years, but it's only about 150. When I was 10, there were relatives of mine that were close to 100 that remembered the first white man that came to BC. My uncle, great uncle Katsalama, could recite the names of the first 1,000 people that came to Vancouver. It's like, it's so new. So we remember all the people, and then their descendants. Yeah, we could track them. We know who's who. But the British people that came, they're the ones that put a black guy in charge of us, Douglas, Governor Douglas. And he was very fair. And then they got rid of him because the white guys kept making noise that from the States, up in this, you know, the name for a black guy is going to, is in charge. And of course, they got rid of him. And they put Trench in there, who was much more conservative and less inclined to make deals with us. So that's part of our memory too. That, well, when this black guy was in charge, things weren't so bad. Now they put this white guy there, holy crap. He's not a nice guy. Yeah, and he was supportive of the Yale Towners who were attacking his county constantly. Yes, Beth?
But I mean, I'm familiar with, I was born in the north, and then I'm familiar with like
got a question.
In lore, yeah, I'm lore, Vancouver, and so on, and I remember a lot more Native people being around than I certainly do in this area, which is older, like you said, in lore. And I'm just wondering, as I visit out there now, it's Yale County, and so on, and it just seems like there's less and less of that Native history kind of being out there, except as maybe a tourist kind of. And what's happening with that? Like, is that just more and more?
I think we work in our own communities now. We're in charge of our own finances to a large degree. In the Vancouver Lower Mainland, it started with the Park Royal. I didn't know about Park Royal, right? And it was leased out for 99 years. The lease ran out, and my cousin Joe had been to law school because they let us go to school in 68. Said, "No, you can't have it. You have to get all those buildings out of here. We don't want them." And it freaked everybody out, but eventually they made a deal that was a worthy deal. First of all, they have to hire up to 30% Native people. Doesn't matter if they're from our territory or not, as long as they have 30% Native people working in the businesses that are there and the institutions, plus it has to be tax-free and all these other things. You know, and you have to pay a lot more money than you would pay. So that gave us capital to develop housing. And we started building, we passed a law against individual housing. And it's because as Stockbridge people, we never had individual housing before. We had long houses. That's an apartment, people, with a very nice amenity space, right? So that's what we started doing. And we started renting out at cost plus 7% to our band members. Now, that makes the rent on my reserve something like $600 a month for a two-bedroom apartment as opposed to $1,800 for a Canadian owned apartment. Somebody's making an awful lot of filthy money. You understand? And we're still making ourselves rich from that. And then it just grew from there. So a lot of us now work for each other, and a lot of Native people that are from elsewhere work for us too. Yeah? And there's a lot of organizations that we have in the cities that Native people work at. And we're busy trying to build something as opposed to just listlessly wandering around trying to recover from shell shock.
Just to like tie with, I thought it was really interesting the way you tied the Kameshi to the history of Canada, because I think that they do tie well together. And I just wanted to ask, do you think there's kind of a way to correlate the two in the sense that in the way that the average public reacted when the story first came out, because the way that Kameshi had taken control of the story and put his twist on it, and the way people doubted the survivors, do you think they're the same way?
We always doubt the victims.
Well, and that's what I'm saying.
Yeah, that's part of the colonization.
Do that exactly.
It's like, you know, we stole this land fair and square, get over it. It's the attitude, yeah. And we have to change that attitude. And you've been raped fair and square, get over it. You know, go see a counselor. Are you PMSing? I mean, you know, all kinds of things. Are you going to start a toxic environment? You know, you're going to destroy Ganesh. I remember people saying that. You're going to, this guy beat his wife, right? She's going to charge him. And one cop says, charge him. The other cop says, well, you know, you'll destroy his future.
He should have followed that when he fell to her. You know my future. Bam!
Yes.
Did I mention it?
Yeah.
I know who he is. I just finished reading Comeback
earlier.
But anyway, yeah. Well, I guess what you basically said, we're a Métis nation, and that, you know, our roots, like the essence is Métis. And I just had such a hard time with that statement.
Well, it's really simple. For 250 years, they didn't allow anyone but rich men, aristocrats, really, to bring wives. Trudeau. The first Prime Minister Trudeau. Where did he get those cheap loans from? That family's been there for 200 years. And there's two branches to it. the Quebecois branch, and then the Canadian branch. Same family. And so he has Algonquin roots. So does his son Justin. Justin looks more like his mother, who's Scott. So that's it. That's what it is. It's not that the guys didn't know it. And when an epidemic occurs, who dies? The men. Because the women, our women, take care of the children and the men first. And so a lot of men died during those epidemics. So we had a nation of a lot of women, very few men. First guy off the boat, I'll take you, buddy. Because children are the foundation of a nation, not the adults.
Because now it's the infants that are...
Exactly. There are more children in care than there ever were in residential school. My mother was right. She did go back to school. She reduced the population of children in care from 50 to 10% and died doing it. It just killed her when she had hurt so hard. And then it went shot right back up after she died. It wasn't even 2 years back up to 50%. So, you know, the women are suing Canada for it. I don't know how far they'll get, but we have to do something about that as communities. Because now the face of the person grabbing the kids is, we're making rules based on their rules. Now, if you take an institution like this, and plant it into a Native community, it's not a Native university, is it? It's still a Canadian university, but now it's in at home. We have to look at who we are and what caring for children is all about for us. Here's the thing. I did this ceremony when I was two. And we dressed up like Blue Moose, not this guy. Some guy paints himself, sticks in his hair, and goes, ha, ha, right in my face. Of course, I scream my head off and escape from fear. And then the women try to stop him. He attacks them all. And all these people are singing, ha, 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 ha. It's just a crazy cacophony of nutsness. And then Jonequa comes in, and she's on stilts, 10 feet tall. She dances into the place, and she starts dancing with Bukus. And if she outdances him, he has to go in his bloody mess and go make peace with every single child. It usually takes him 4 days. Now, what does it do for us? Well, I'll tell you, made me fearless. That crazy guy couldn't get me. We brought him to his knees. One more than dancing. And then I became a Jinagua dancer. And it took me 8 years to do the training to be a Jinagua dancer. Because, you know, we dance funny, eh? Only on stilts. It's amazing. And hours. And the guy I was dancing against was the first non-native kung fu master of the Chinese Kung Fu Club. So he was in shape, right? I danced him. And it does something for our community to stop men from abusing us. Now, what's the problem now? Oh, that's abusive to the children. Who's saying it? So we don't have that ceremony now. And that ceremony is the block abuse.
and it worked. So we have to reconceive of ourselves as we once were, not the broken, fractured messes we are now. And it's unfortunate that we didn't create any of these problems, but we're the only ones that can solve them. We're sitting right here in this room. We're the only ones that can fix it. You can't get a counselor from outside to come in and rebuild this. But that just fractures us more, isn't it?
Well, you can make it about I can read, I'm walking to the addiction problem that's happening right now. And, you know, we're all mental health, really. But the people who support the addictions truly believe that it's our love to get rid of them. I know that too. And so you're saying, you know, it's us that support them, like, and I think that what is being done is not normal. There's lots of people who are trying to explain the whole Indian Act and why, you know, keeping the women out is not our law. But I mean, they really believe it. It's
wrong attitude.
Oh, I love this question. This is beautiful. No, nothing to do with Indian Act. It has to do with naturalization. If you're a nation, you naturalize people. It has to do with nationhood.
Yeah. No, but I don't blame you because you're saying, you said, you know.
Take it out of that pork barrel.
How can we do the work? I mean, or.
You have to start talking about nationhood and naturalizing your citizens. Every one of them. Every single one of them. It's what we're doing in Tsleil-Waututh too. Now, we're not a very big First Nation, but we're naturalizing everybody because we've got Irish people there. They have no native blood whatsoever, black people there. And we have to have a single nation. They're married in, right? And we have to have a single nation. Now, we have to naturalize them. So they have to go in the longhouse to be naturalized. They have to start learning the language to be naturalized. Some of our new citizens are better at being Scots than some of our older ones. That happens in any country, I guess. So, we gotta think as a nation. What's our responsibility? And what's the Tree of Peace all about? And look at the words. You know what? I had an epiphany one day. I was saying to my kids, you know what it says? It says we're supposed to take care of the earth. And they said, yeah. And you always said, you know, that all else fails, there's the law. If you can't be a good person, you can be a kind person, you can at least be a lawful one, right? Obey the law. And I said, yeah, but it doesn't say Native people. It says people. So it's your law, too. And that's what naturalization is all about. We have to take care of the land. I mean, even if that's the only commitment you can make to this territory, you'll be doing good. So look at the words in your language. Look at the words in your language when you say those laws. It will change you. And invade other people again. And you just have to, you know, with Six Nations, you just have to bring up the question. And just be with, they'll start arguing with each other.
I have experience with you.
And sing with my people, we're longouts, right? Debate that goes on. But bring up the question. And then sit back. They're always bringing up the question. And then when that argument settles, another question is left unanswered. No matter which way it went, you've got to find that question and bring it up again. A new question. And eventually, you rebirth the wondering that is natural to us. Because we're not wondering anymore. We're fighting. We when you're fighting, you're not wondering what they look like. You're defending. You gotta bring out the curiosity and the wonder. And as women, it's your responsibility. Because that's the fundamental thing about all house people, is we wonder about things. How do you think we got to know that this was very violent? If you look at it from the sky, it looks like a turtle. How do you think we know that? Well, there's a little place in the brain here where you can jump out of your body and fly around. Science is not testing it. And we knew that before. People laughed at us for it.
Yeah, that's pretty crazy.
But now, they know where it comes from in the brain. So we would fly around and look from a very... That's a lot of wondering. That's amazing wondering. It's just what we're capable of. The wondering that we're capable of. We have to restore that, not just in the Shoshone communities, but Ojibwe communities, Inuit communities, because it traumatized people, the first thing that gets killed is the curiosity. That's the crime. We don't want to wonder about things because I just got off that fucking Irish ship, the killer ship. I don't want to wonder about anything. I just got out of Cabbage Town. I don't want to wonder about anything. They shipped me to Port Dover and took away the roads. Yeah. Gotta restore the wonder. And this is a good place for it. The universe is always a good place. And this conference is a great place for that. Wonder about everything. Thank you very much, people.
We do have books here. I know there's a table there. Somebody said she's going to put the books on the table, so.
Thank you, Lee. On behalf of the Aboriginal Services, Sandra Wong is asking to give you a ceremony and tobacco for the Six Nations. On behalf of Brock University and Center for Canadian Studies and all the people here, thank you for coming tonight. Just don't go all the way through the exit. Thank you very much, everybody.